Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to St. Peter's this morning. The order of service that we will follow can be found in your worship folder as we, on this Sunday, our service theme, our worship focus is words followed by works. And we'll see how Jesus, when he says something, he always follows it with action. A little bit later on in our service, we will be celebrating the Lord's Supper, and you're all asked to please take a look at our communion practice as it's found on the first page in your worship folder. A couple notes for you for this service. Communion is at the rail, ushered from the center as you go out to the side here. If you take an individual cup, you do have the receptacles located at each side. So center, and follow the direction of the ushers. Also, please note, the entire liturgy, the liturgy can be found in your worship folder and also on the screens, the entire liturgy. However, unless you have a large print worship folder, the hymns and the psalm is from the hymnal. They won't be on the screen, it's in the hymnal. So please keep that in mind as well. So with all that, let's raise our hearts and our voices in song and praise with the first hymn, hymn 551. Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Let us confess our sins to the Lord. Holy God, gracious Father, I am sinful by nature and have sinned against you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have not loved you with my whole heart. I have not loved others as I should. I deserve your punishment both now and forever. But Jesus, my Savior, paid for my sins with his innocent suffering and death. Trusting in him, I pray, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Our gracious Father in heaven, has been merciful to us. He sent his only Son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life as the atoning sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. This holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have
mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord Jesus Christ, you are the good shepherd who laid down your life for the sheep. Lead us now to the still waters of your life-giving word, that we may abide in your Father's house forevermore. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Our first lesson on this, the third Sunday of Easter, is taken from the Old Testament, or from the New Testament book of Acts, chapter 13. You can follow along if you wish on the screen or on the inside pages of your worship folder. As we see that Jesus fulfilled works, it shows that every promise that he makes will ultimately come true. We see that in this lesson. We read. After the reading of the law and the prophets, the leaders of the synagogue sent a message to them saying, "Gentlemen, brothers, if you have a word of encouragement for the people, say it." Then Paul stood up, motioned with his hand and said, "Gentlemen, brothers, sons of Abraham's family, and those among you who fear God, this message of salvation has been sent to you. The people of Jerusalem and their rulers did not recognize him. By condemning him, they fulfilled the statements of the prophets that are read every Sabbath. And though they found no grounds for a death sentence, they asked Pilate to have him executed. When they carried out everything that was written about him, they took him down from the cross and laid him in a tomb. But God raised him from the dead. And for many days he was seen by those who had come up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem. These same individuals are now his witnesses to the people. We are preaching to you the good news about the promise that was made to our fathers. God has fulfilled this promise for us, their children, by raising up Jesus. As it is also written in the second Psalm, "You are my son, today I have begotten you," that God would raise him from the dead, never again to be subject to decay. God said in this way, "I will give you the holy and sure blessings promised to David." Therefore, he also says in another place, "You will not let your Holy One see decay." For David, after he had served God's purpose in his own generation, fell asleep, was laid to rest with his fathers, and saw decay. But the one God raised did not see decay. So, gentlemen, brothers, let it be known to you that through this Jesus, forgiveness of sins is being proclaimed to you. Also forgiveness from everything from which you could not be justified through the law of Moses. In this Jesus, everyone who believes is justified. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We continue by singing Psalm 23. You can find that on page 23 in the front of your hymnal. I will sing through the refrain once. You're invited to sing the second time, and then we will all together sing the verses. Psalm 23.
Forever, amen. I will.
Our second lesson for today is taken from the book of Hebrews chapter 13. And it's here that we see Jesus as the shepherd who equips you to live as his sheep. We read, "Now may the God of peace, who brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, in connection with his blood, which established the eternal testament, may he equip you with every good thing to do his will, as he works in us what is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the gospel acclamation. Gospel according to St. John chapter 10, which will also serve as the base for the sermon this morning. Then the festival of dedication took place in Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was walking in the temple area in Solomon's colonnade. So the Jews gathered around Jesus, asking, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly." Jesus answered them, "I did tell you, but you do not believe. The works I am doing in my Father's name testify about me, but you do not believe because you are not my sheep, as I said to you. My sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ. Please be seated as we continue with the next hymn. Hymn 631, "Speak, O Savior, I am listening." Hymn 631. It was a sunny afternoon, sunny Sunday afternoon in Texas when the telephone rang. And on the phone was a retired pastor who was wintering in the area where I had served in deep South Texas. He was a good friend of mine and faithful servant. He took me under his wing and mentored me in the early years of my ministry. And when he called, I thought I did something wrong in that morning's worship. But he said he wanted me to come over to the house. And he wanted me to come over to the house because he said he had doubts. He knew that his life on this earth was short, and he was troubled. And he asked me, he said, "Is it really all true? Is it really all true? Is Jesus really the only way to heaven? Is Jesus really the Savior? Is he really my Savior? Is Jesus really the Savior?" You know, people throughout time have been asking that question, right? In fact, we see that question being asked in the lesson before us from the Gospel according to St. John. The Jews gathered around Jesus asking, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly." Well, these religious leaders of the Jews, they had heard Jesus speak. They had heard Jesus just a couple months earlier say how he is the good shepherd. They had heard him say that he had authority over life and death. They had heard him say that he even had the authority to lay down his life and take it up again. But they didn't like the answer that Jesus gave them. It wasn't the answer that they wanted to hear. Well, how does Jesus respond to them? Did you see that? He says, "I did tell you, but you do not believe. The works I am doing in my Father's name testify about me." Jesus is blunt here. "I told you already. I told you again and again and again, and you refuse to believe. And if you refuse to listen, at least look. At least look at what I am doing. I don't just speak words. I follow it up with actions. Look at my miracles. Look at my miracles and compare them to the Old Testament prophecies. The lame walk, the blind see. These works testify and witness to who I am." How could those religious leaders not see? How could they not hear? How could they not believe Jesus' words? How? "You do not believe because you are not my sheep." Ouch, right? That's pretty harsh. And yet when I take a look at this verse, can Jesus say the same to me? Can he say the same to you? "You are not my sheep." You know, those words crush me because I know that there is inside of me a little unbeliever, just as there is one inside of each of you. It's called the sinful nature. And that sinful nature, it doesn't want anything to do with God. It doesn't want anything to do with Jesus. It doesn't want to do anything to do with that shepherd Jesus. It doesn't want to and refuses to listen to Jesus' voice. It would rather tell the shepherd that it is in charge. It would rather have God listen and follow our voice instead of the other way around. And that's the issue, isn't it? That's the issue. Whose voice do you follow and whose voice do you listen to? the shepherd or the sinful nature. And it's a struggle that each of us go through day after day, right? How do we even recognize whose voice is speaking? Is it the shepherd or is it the sinful nature? Whose voice is speaking when you hear things like this? It's okay not to forgive. It's okay not to forgive that person who's hurt you because, after all, they don't deserve it and they need to hurt just as much as you. Whose voice is talking there? It's okay to have sex before marriage because, after all, you got to get to know the person that you're marrying, right? Whose voice is that? Or it's okay to cut down and ridicule our elected leaders because they're idiots. They don't know what they're doing and you didn't vote for them. Whose voice is that? So whose voice do you and I listen to? Whose voice do you and I follow? It's easy to listen and follow that voice of the sinful nature, that little rebel inside of us. But look at what Jesus says. You are not my sheep. Follow after that voice. You are not my sheep. And he doesn't mince words here, does he? And so let us repent, each of us. Repent of those times when we listened to and we followed after any voice but Jesus. Silence the voice of that sinful nature inside of you with repentance. Repent, and then listen to the voice of your shepherd speaking to you. And listen to what he calls you. He calls you his sheep. You know, how in the world can that be? By the way, God bless you, whoever sneezed. How in the world can that be that God would call us his sheep after what you and I have done? How can he choose us to be his own? And here's the thing, go to the cross and listen. Do you hear your shepherd's voice? Do you hear it? As he cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? It is there that Jesus has taken your sin. Jesus has taken your sin's punishment. There is none left for you. Go to the cross. Go to the cross and listen. Do you hear your shepherd's voice? Do you hear it? It is finished. He cries out. He dies. And with him dies your sin. You are forgiven. But don't stop there. Go to the empty tomb. Go to the empty tomb and listen. Do you remember what the angels proclaimed? He has risen just as he said, because the shepherd's resurrection guarantees that you will follow him to the heavenly pastures. And yet God's not done. Because he wants to make sure that you know that you are his sheep. He wants to make sure that you never doubt that you are his sheep. And so go to your baptism. Do you hear it? Listen. Your shepherd commanded that you be baptized in the name of the Father and Son and Holy Spirit. He has chosen you and covered you with his life, his death, his resurrection. And that's still not the end. Because your Savior, your shepherd, your Jesus knows you. He knows you through and through. He knows the temptations that you face day after day. He knows the sinful nature that assaults you. He knows those voices that try to lead you astray. And so he speaks to you and holds you as he speaks to you in his word. And he speaks to you in the supper. This is my body, this is my blood for you. Your shepherd feeds your soul with forgiveness after having made you his sheep. So how do you respond? Seeing what Jesus has done and continues to do for you, how do you respond? You follow. You follow him. And where does he lead you? I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. Just imagine that. Picture it in your mind. You rest in the nail-scarred hand of Jesus. You are safe. You are secure. No matter what temptations the devil would throw at you, no matter what accusations the sinful nature would assault you with, no matter what trials and troubles and chaos surround you, you're in the Savior's grasp. You're in his hand. And even when you face death, and we all will unless the Lord comes again, even when you face death, you have a Savior, you have a shepherd, you have Jesus, who has already gone through the valley of the shadow of death and returns to bring you through that death valley to heaven, just as he said. Do you remember? Because I live, you also live. And if that's not enough, Jesus, like he always does, he piles it on. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and the Father are one. Doesn't that just take your breath away? Jesus and the Father are one, holding you in their hand. They are one in moving heaven and earth, time and eternity, to save you, to care for you, to bring you to heaven. You rest, you are safe in the hand of the Almighty. What have you to fear? What have you really to fear? And I was reminded of one of my favorite hymns. It was written by Martin Luther, and he wrote this: "What harm can sin and death now do? The true God now abides with you. Let hell and Satan storm and rave. Christ is your brother. Christ is your shepherd. You are safe." Return to the verses of our lesson when you're troubled. Return to these verses when the days are long and your temper's short. Return to these verses when darkness clouds your thoughts, your mind. Return to these verses and listen to your Savior, your shepherd's voice. No one will snatch you out of my hand. I immediately went over to that retired pastor's house. And I knew the doubts, I knew the questions, I knew the voice of the sinful nature that he faced, because I face it every day. And so when I got to the house, he didn't want me to argue with him. He didn't want me to question him. He didn't want me to say, you know, you've been a pastor for how many years? You know this. He didn't want any of that. He only asked of me one thing. He said, "Joel, tell me about Jesus." He wanted to hear Jesus' word and Jesus' promises. He wanted to hear the voice of his Savior, and only that voice. May each of us desire the same. Amen. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard and keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus until life everlasting. Amen. We continue by confessing our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen,
We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated for prayer. Special prayers this morning, and we pray for Mary Larson. We pray for Rachel and Chloe, the niece and grandniece of Bill and Sue Karras. We pray for Pete and Angela Brickner, those who are hospitalized, Gloria Meyer, Jay Zahn, and we also pray for Pastor Schrader as he deliberates the divine calls that he now has here at St. Peter's and one in Florida. Let us pray to the Lord. Almighty God, Heavenly Father, hear us and grant our requests as we enjoy this privilege of prayer given us by Jesus. Lord, we pray for Mary Larson that you keep your promise to give her the strength she needs as she prepares for surgery this coming Wednesday, and that you guide the doctors and nurses' hands for a successful surgery, keeping both Mary and her family in your care. We pray for Rachel and Chloe, the niece and grandniece of Bill and Sue Karras, giving you thanks that you answered our prayers and that you keep them in your almighty hand as they continue to look to you. We pray for Pete and Angela Brickner as they celebrate 20 years of marriage. As you have been with them in the past, continue to guide and protect them in the future. Be with them, Lord, and shower your blessings down upon them as they together live for you. We pray for those who are sick and in the hospital, especially Gloria Meyer and Jay Zahn, that you give them your peace, your comfort, knowing that you will not forsake them, for in Jesus you have made them your children. We pray for Pastor Schrader and his family as he deliberates where best to serve you. Give him discernment and wisdom and joy as he shepherds those you entrust to his care, and give him peace in his decision. These prayers and all those which you see in our hearts, grant by the mercy and grace of our Savior Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. At this time, announcements are made on the internet and radio. If you did bring a physical offering, you can please feel free to use the offering plates at the entry to the sanctuary, or you can use the link for online giving in the worship folder. Also, at this time, if you could all make use of the friendship guest books located on the aisle side of the pew, please sign your name, number. Pleasure having you with us. May the Lord continue to bless your worship.
Good morning. You are listening to the worship service of St. Peter's Lutheran Church in Sturgeon Bay, Wisconsin. St. Peter's is affiliated with the Wisconsin Evangelical Lutheran Synod, or WELS. The WELS is a worldwide church with congregations serving all 50 states and Canada, and also serves over 25 foreign countries through world missions. The worship folder is sponsored by Pete and Angela Brickner in honor of their 20th wedding anniversary coming up on May 4th. We thank you for joining us in our worship today. If you would like to contribute to St. Peter's ministry, you're welcome to mail your offerings to the church at 108 West Maple Street, Sturgeon Bay, Wisconsin, 54235, or make a donation online at stpeterslutheran.net. Thank you for supporting our ministry to share Christ. God's blessings to you today and always from St. Peter's Lutheran Church, right here in Sturgeon Bay, Wisconsin.
Please stand as we continue with the sacrament of the altar.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who by his willing sacrifice on the cross took away the sins of the world, and by his glorious resurrection restored everlasting life. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song. Blessed are you, Lord God, eternal King and gracious Father. In love you made us the crown of your creation. In mercy you planned our salvation. In grace you sent your Son to redeem us from sin. We remember and give you thanks that your eternal Son, Jesus Christ, became flesh and made his dwelling among us, that he willingly placed himself under law to redeem those under law, that he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death on a cross, that he has destroyed death, and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. Bless us as we receive your Son's body and blood in this sacrament. Forgive our sins, increase our faith, strengthen our fellowship, and deepen our longing for the day when Christ will welcome us to his eternal feast. Praise and thanks and honor and glory be to you, O God our Father, and to your Son and to the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. And this is my body, which is given for you. And do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen.